Hi and welcome to this new SMOD Academy session. I'm Francis Mast, the founder of SMOD, and today I'm with Erwan, which is product specialist at SMODtech. Hi Erwan, how are you doing?
Hi, fine, thank you. Welcome to this live about particles, the second one. Don't hesitate to ask some questions on the YouTube chat, and I will forward them to Francis. So, Francis, I let you the mic.
Okay, thanks a lot, Erwan. So, just for those that watched us yesterday, we had a lot of connection troubles, and apparently things are much better today. So, it should be all fine. And let's start immediately. I just need to find my mouse cursor and we will be able to start. Here it is. Okay. So we'll simply start with a new compo. One important setting is the gamma value. We'll set this one to linear so as to work with HDR, a high dynamic range, which often gives better results. Also, we don't need the alpha layer, so it's unchecked here. And we just keep the resolution full HD. So today's topic is particles. So the first thing we are going to do is to create a system of particles. So we are going to create it with the default state, so as to configure everything by ourselves. But as a small reminder, like for any other effect in SMOD, you can grab any directly made presets from this summon. But we won't do this for now. So when you open the particles layer, you have different things. The first one is the internal player of the simulator. So you can freeze, for example, your simulation, play it again, or change the speed of your particles simulation. And this is an infinite length transport, so it will by default never loop, but you can like change also force it looping or go more in the parameters. The second thing is the emitter of the particles. So by default, it's a single point, which we can see here, which is emitting. But today I'm going to change this to a plane. So there are a few different primitives available. And we are going to take the plane. And the parameter we have after is the direction of the particles when they are created. So what I want is let them go from bottom to top. So I select the normal, which will take the normal direction to the plane. So maybe we can move a bit the camera in order to better see what's happening now. And this plane, I'm going to put it a bit below the floor, so at -5 meters, for example. And also, I'm going to change a bit the initial speed of the particles. So let's say 3. And also their lifetime. So I think 5 seconds is enough. So as a reminder, you can use the dot character in order to specify seconds. So now the particles are leaving 5 seconds and they have an initial speed of 3, maybe, which is slightly too much. So let's say 2. Oh, problem with my numeric pad. Okay, like this works. Also, one very important parameter is the rate of the creation of particles. So 100 means it's creating 100 particles every second. So if you go to the advanced parameters, you can have some more info and see exactly how many particles are in the system at a given time. So currently, we generate 100 particles every second. And those particles have a lifetime of 5 seconds, which leads to a total number of 500 particles. So now if I add a zero here, for example, we can see the number of particles is rising exactly in 5 seconds till the new count, which is 5,000. So this rate parameter is very important, and since we want to have an easy access to it, we will expose it. So we don't know yet the exact bounds that we want. So instead of using an expose as percentage, we can simply expose it as itself. So there is no transformation applied on it. And now we have a direct control of the rate of our particle system. Next thing you need to know is the points attribute modifier. So this is the easy shortcut in order to change properties of particles depending on one selector. So by default, the selector is the edge, which means that these tracks correspond to properties in function of the edge. So for example, if we take the color, we can decide to maybe let them start white, then we create another key where they will be blue or pink. Then we create another key with, again, another color. And we can maybe go to something darker for the last key. I'm not so good at selecting gradients, sorry about that, but maybe this one. So as you can see, the color gradient that I just created is now impacting the particles depending on their age inside the system. So age is the default mode. One very common trick also is to reduce the alpha at the very end. So we create a key for this and tell that at 100% of the age, the opacity should be zero. And now we have a nicely particle smoothing out just before dying. So in this same tracks, you can also change the scale. So for example, we could let them become bigger at the end. And maybe do the alpha smooth out smaller, longer over time. And now we have something like evaporating or something like this. So these are things you can very easily do inside the point attribute with this default edge setting. But you can also change the selector. So for example, if I put a sphere, so let's find the sphere. Yeah, the sphere is in the center. Now it's colorizing and applying the presets depending on the position inside the sphere. So maybe I need to make the effect a bit more apparent. So let me quickly change a bit the colors. So here the scale is 1, then scale becomes 5, another key at 5, and then we go back to 1. And now we have this interval that we can directly configure where the particle reacts. And thanks to the sphere selector, we can directly change either the radius of this effect or its central position. So doing drag and drops is a bit difficult for me right now, but I think you see the idea. So this is an example of a sphere selector. We can also give the example of using a noise function. So now this is a 3D noise, which is computed for every position. And depending on the value of this 3D noise, the tracks are looked up and this gives properties, the values of the properties. You can also give the example of the random. And now what's happening is that for every single particle, we take a random position inside the tracks and this defines the behavior of this particle. So it's possible to chain multiple point attribute modifiers, and also you can chain them with the more classical other attribute modifiers, like for example the exposure. So now we are going a bit too far. Strangely. And again, for this one, we could combine with masks and so on. So now I'm going to focus on another possible selector, which is the velocity. So this one only makes sense for physical particles when we do particles. And inside the velocity, you can configure a minimum and a maximum. So I think now we need to change a bit the scale. So now what happens is that all the particles for the moment have the same velocity. So they look up at the same position inside the tracks to get their properties. But the next step is going to make this system a bit more complex by adding some fields. So basically what a particle system does is a kind of physical simulation. And what a field is a force that we add to the simulation. So the simplest example is the gravity. So gravity actually is a constant force. Let's make it a bit stronger. And now we see a kind of Fontaine effect. I'm going to make the screen a bit bigger because we don't need the files for the moment. And then we can have a better feedback. Okay. Sorry about that. I have some problems. Yes. So now we have this. Okay, let's make the gravity a bit less. And what we see is the particles now, depending on the velocity, are changing their properties. And maybe by, so sorry, I'm just trying to make the parameters a bit better. So here is my gravity, -1. I can slightly increase the initial speed. And I can also configure a bit the maximum velocity I want to focus on. So, maybe to explain better what's happening, we can simplify the function we are using. So we are going to put low velocities with a blue color, for example. And high velocities will be red. So what happens at the top of the system is that the particles have lower and lower velocity before falling again, and then the velocity increases again. So maybe to highlight the particles that reach close to zero velocity, we are going to add a key in the scale. So for low velocity particles, we are going to increase their size. Yes. So now we see exactly those that are the most statical, those that move the less. So gravity was one example. I can show you another example, which is the attractor. So gravity actually is a constant force, while the attractor more corresponds to the actual gravity that occurs in space. So it corresponds to putting a mass into space and letting this mass affect the particles around it. So let's increase the mass in question. And now what we see is the reaction sorry, the visualization is always a bit tricky with particles because we want something really readable. Let's just maybe increase the size of the particles a bit. Oh, not that much. Yes, okay. So now we have this attractor, so it can be a mass that attracts, so now this is a very powerful mass, or we can also set it negative and then it will behave as a repulsor. So now all the particles are repulsed by this attractor. Another interesting field is the friction. So the friction basically behaves like the wind, which is or the air in which the particle moves, that slows them down. So all the particles get naturally slowed down, and at the end they have zero velocity, which is why now they are getting big. And one very interesting aspect of fields is that you can also combine them with masks. So for example, if I want this friction to occur only inside the box, inside the sphere, sorry, I can create this sphere. So let's make it maybe 3 meters radius. And now you can see that only the particles that go inside the sphere get slowed down by the friction. So we can do this combination of masks with fields on any type of field. So for example, now I kept the gravity, but only inside the sphere. So maybe I need to make my gravity a bit stronger to make it apparent what happens. Yes, and now only the balls that are inside the sphere will be impacted by the gravity field. So that was it about the fields. There are some others that I have not detailed, but you can try them by yourself. One very common, maybe we can quickly do a vortex, which is the good field to create tornado effects. So there is a falloff strength. Also, you can attract the particles to the center. So let's put some more of them. Just playing a bit with the parameters. And also here you can see, for example, there is an attenuation function, which is a falloff. But everywhere where you have such functions, you can replace it by any type of parametric function. And this enables to multiply the number of combinations. So I'm not going into depth into this, but yeah, it gives you a bit an idea of what you can achieve by configuring the fields and combining them with masks. So that was it for fields, and I will let Erwan continue on rendering techniques.
Thank you, Francis. So as you have maybe seen, the way to display the particles is set it here. So by default, it's a PNG, a dot white PNG. So if I zoom a little on my field of my particles field, I can see that these pictures is used to render each particles. And there is a very interesting things about these pictures used. It's because it works also with a selector, the same as we have seen for points attributes. It's basically here an age selector. What happens if I, for example, add these pictures of a cross to the list of the renderer? It happens that at the birth of my particles, they are displayed with the cross, and at the death of the particles, they are displayed as the dot.png. And at the middle of their lives, you see that there is a smooth transition between them. This is set it with these parameters. So inside your particles, particles emitters, you have this, the last, the very last parameters, default point sprite. This allow you to select and parse some pictures and some 2D generators as renderer for particles. And here you have the interpolation, which is in linear, which means that SMOD will, through the age or through the selector you have selected, so it, in this case it's the age, it will make a linear interpolation from the cross to the dot. So if I put this in nearest instead of linear, as you can see, here you have a very straight transition between the cross and the dot inside my particle field. So it means that at the middle of the edge, my particles switch from displayed from the cross to a dot. So you can add multiple 2D renderer, 2D generator, sorry, to the list. By default, it's displayed like this inside inside the particles particle systems. It's basically the same as if you create, so right click over the particles, if you create a sprite point. So if you create sprite points, another, so here in this case, I add another renderer to my particle systems. So let's put this one off. Yes, put it this one off. Up, unfold the very first one. Here, as you can see, I have my type of renderer, so default point, and also the selector, so it's age, and the different pictures or 2D generator used to display my particles. You are able also to use different generators offered by SMOD, but you are also able to use sprite sheet to display your particles. So for example, if you want to use, let's see, I think we do have some.
You have the roses just below in the files.
I think others might be more clear for this example. Okay. Let's go into the files. Inside the standard pack, in texture, you have a folder. You have a folder called particles. Can see it or sprite or sprite sheet. Sorry, let's just I have some latency also today with the servers. So here you have three different sprite sheets for displaying particles. So this is the pictures we want to use. So as you can see, it's subdivided in 20 sub-pictures per one row. So you can add this type of renderer to your particle system. So let's simply drag and drop these pictures inside my default point and switch off the cross and the dot. So inside your default point renderer, you have access to the last parameters, which allow you to tell Smud how many different pictures you have in RAW and how many different particles you have in different pictures you have in columns. So automatically, Smud will cut these pictures and display it through the selectors you have. So for example, here I know that this is 20 per one, so I set this first parameter to 20. Okay, no, 20. And I don't think it's clear with the points attribute, so let's just hide this parameter, this modifier, sorry. And here,
you probably also need to select the depth sorting.
Yes, 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 and put it into add also.
You have the depth sorted option.
Yes, I try to get it, but with the latency, it's it's tricky.
Let me try.
Okay.
Okay, this is with the depth, and we are going also to disable the depth test, the depth at all. And I think, so let me check the image. So yes, let's try with fewer particles. And we can make those particles bigger in order to better see what happens. We can remove also the fields to go back to a clean state. Okay, and we also need to change the blending mode in order to be in additive mode. Yes, I think that's better.
Yes.
Maybe we can go. Reduce a bit or not the transparency, and I let you continue. Erwan, maybe we last thing is to put the linear filtering again.
Yes, because here Smud will straight pick some pictures through age. So I need to. Oh, it's already set it to linear too. Do you have made the
thing? Yeah, okay. I just did it for you.
Okay.
And I'm thinking as a last thing, we might need to reduce the lifetime. Okay, so I think an explosion should be something like 1 second. Yes, and now here are. Our explosions. So there would be many ways to make this look better, but I think you can continue.
Yes, thank you, Francis. So as you can see, you can simply add multiple pictures or multiple generators to your default point because it works thanks a list. And here you can change also the selector. So. Here, by default, because it's more useful to have it, it's age based, but you also are able to change the selector through, for example, I think we can take the velocity too and put an attractor field to this one, and maybe increase the lifetime. It was 5 seconds, I think, before. So this is what happened. My attractor field is changing the velocity of the particles. So Smud will choose one of the pictures of the explosion. So if I visualize my explosion.png files, this is the highest velocity, and this is the lowest velocity, and here you have middle velocity. So I don't think...
I think you need to increase the maximum velocity inside the velocity selector.
Yes.
Put it to 5 maybe instead of 1.
5. Okay, maybe I just need to unzoom a little. So this is what you
yeah,
get.
I think
sorry,
let
Francis?
Us try with the. Can we try with the gravity and the sphere? Maybe?
Yes, or maybe this? A friction.
Yeah,
a friction with.
I think the linking to the velocity is not the simplest example. There is one very simple example, which is doing it with a sphere, and then you can see depending on the position inside the sphere. How or also you can use, for example, a linear mask. This can be very useful. And then, depending on the position along a given line, you will have the different sprites appearing magically. Yeah, please continue.
Thank you. So you, this is the common way to display some particles. You have also the option to display with different the different renderers. So you have someone very very interesting, which is the ballpoint. So ballpoint simulates an instantiation of particles in sphere. So it's not real sphere. I think, Francis, you can explain better than me how it works. But this...
Yeah, so it's a kind of hack, because basically, like for the sprite points, we are displaying camera-facing sprites, so simply quads that are in front of the camera. But the sprites that do not contain a fixed image, like it was the case for the sprite points, but they compute a light sphere image that is specific to every particle. So it's a kind of ray tracing, but very cheap. Mm-hmm. And with this, you can display many, many particles.
And this renderer, it's quite, it's very lighter than the instantiate operator. We will see this one on particles in few minutes. But this renderer can allow you to optimize very quickly some composition that works with particles and sphere like that. So I strongly advise you to use it when you want to create particles with sphere. Use bond points instead of sphere if you don't need to distort or work on the sphere mesh on your composition. You also have other way to do that with box. So you can add box points, for example, to as renderer. So it's basically the same tricks as ballpoint. And this is a good way also to not use the instantiate operator, which is the effects of particles we have to see now. So let's transform our particles into 3D objects. We have seen this modifier before on the modifiers tutorial on the YouTube live. So if you right click over your particle system, you have an instantiate operator. This instantiate operator transform every particles into a 3D object inside the list of the instantiate. And as you can see, you retrieve also the selector logics. So basically here it's a box. I don't see anything because all my renderers are disabled. So to see a box better, I will add a surface. And this is what we get. You have here at the difference of box point renderer a real in kind of real box instantiate for every particles. you have also the possibility to drag and drop 3D files inside your instantiate operator. So I will decrease a little the emission rate, maybe to 20, and drag and drop files, 3D FBX of air balloon inside my instantiate. So instead of having a box, I want to have a 3D object. And I can maybe increase the size of the 3D objects, so to 4. And this is what I get. My particles are now air balloon. And it's basically also the same logic as the default point renderer. You have an operator that picks a 3D object to display particles over a selector. So here it's randomly take or a balloon or a box if this one is activated. And here, box is activated. So as you can see, I have also balloon and boxes displayed. You also can add multiple and different 3D objects. You are not limited under that. So let's import another one. This one is a flower. It's quite heavy. So let's decrease the size of it. 0.1. And this is what I get. Box, air balloon, and flower through a pick randomly as to display my particles. So I can change also the selector. Let's put it to the edge. So it bursts as balloon and deactivate the field to see it better. It bursts as balloon, it became flower, and death die as boxes. So it's kind of a trippy particle system, as you can see, but it's explained, or I hope it explained well, how selectors works and give you some ideas of what you can do as compositing and compositing and some other compositing techniques, thanks the generative logics of SMUD. I don't remember what I have to explain. Yes, I don't know if there is any question. No. Francis, do you have an idea of what maybe you can explain the trail techniques for particles?
Sorry, I'm here. So sure, I will continue. And just to finish this, maybe I can show a little trick, which is to use the point scale modifier. So it has to be done before the instantiate. So now what the point scale is doing is just making the instances bigger.
Maybe just a quick reminder of the order of the modifier, because the point scale before the instantiate is something very, very important to understand.
So, let me explain it. So what happens is that every particle or every vertex in a 3D model has a point scale and point rotate attributes, as well as a color attribute. So every vertex has different attributes, and the point scale here is modifying the values of those attributes. And when it comes to the instantiate operator is going to read the value of the scale attributes that are stored on every vertex, and is going to create the size of the instantiated object depending on this. So if we put the point scale after the instantiate, what happens is that the instantiate, when it comes, doesn't have the information on the right scale yet. So it creates default sized objects. And then we are changing the point scale information of the vertices that are inside the instantiated objects. So by the way, we could display those vertices.
Et sinon, il y a une question et je pense que je vais y répondre parce que, à mon avis, c'est quelqu'un qui m'a déjà vu faire.
C'est l'appel au vortex à poisson.
Ok.
Basile. Basile.
Ah, nous sommes de retour.
Are we online, Basile?
We are online.
Oh, hello again. So, apparently we are back. What happened is we asked too much particles to the machine because I used the particle renderer on top of every vertex of every single instance that was created by the instantiates. And in order to make things even worse, with the point scale attribute, the sprites were bigger than usual. And this is the main bottleneck of particles. It's the number of pixels you display at the end, what we call the pixel rate, the fill rate. And it's roughly equal to the size of one sprite times the number of sprites you have to display. So you can, for example, have several millions of particles displayed with one single pixel, but only a few hundreds if you use very large sprites such as cloud images or smoke or whatever. Basil, I'm not sure we are online.
Yes, we are.
Ah, so I have no. And so we have too many particles, and the card tried to compute them, but this monopolized all the resources of the machine, and then the streaming software crashed, and our own connection crashed also, and so on. But we are back. The bad news is we didn't save. The good news is it will be very easy to recreate from scratch. So, I think the next topic will be to show some other possibilities we have in order to create tiles. So let's create again very quickly a system of particles with a plane that emits the particles, the plane slightly below the floor. And with some more speed and only 5 seconds, and we can expose the rates to have an easy access to it. So now that we have these particles, a very nice, and also I want the direction to be normal to the plane, yeah, in order to have this. So a very nice operator is called the motion lines. So the motion lines will connect the successive positions of the particles, and it created a new renderer, which is the renderer for the lines. So in this case, it's default lines, so which Sickness on the effect the renderer called sick lines. So you can change the sickness of those lines here. Now I'm making their bigger. And if we create fields, we should have a good feedback of the effect of the fields. So for example, an attractor. Now you can clearly see the effect of the attractor thanks to the motion lines. So what we can do is put this into additive, maybe not the full half, but more particles. So now we have two separate renderers, one for the points and one for the lines. The default points is here, so also I'm going to reduce a bit the opacity so we can see the overlap of many of them. And here you see some strange rendering. So these artifacts are due to the dev buffer. So for many effects, it's a very simple solution is to simply disable the dev. The dev test. And now we start seeing the field lines induced by the attractor. So by the way, we can take this attractor and move it somehow. Maybe it will be easier in the 3D view. Oh. Or we can turn this one into a repulsor as we used to do. I think we had a question about making fishes, and maybe Erwan is the right person for this.
Yes, yes, yes. This is a very, very old tips and tricks I always explain when I teach some sometimes mod. I don't use particles to make these fishes, but I definitely use motion lines. So let me just disable the particle system and add random points instead. So these are my random points. I want 100 fishes on a sphere. So maybe 2 meters radius for my sphere, and add a 3D transform that make a loop in the Y axis. So create a linear loop. So here it's the movement I get. I can now display the motion lines. So this is the shape it creates. Let's just remove the default lines. And I have already already show how to customize your default lines thanks the drawing of the 2D generator used as default lines. But let me just increase the thickness of my default lines to 100 pixel maybe, or 200. Okay, 200 is correct, or maybe 300. 300 is okay. And transform just this uniform thanks a mask. So let's just change the resolution of this uniform to something more horizontal and add a mask to it. So just simply a Bezier mask and start to draw with control and click. To draw a very, very ugly fish, because drawing is not my specialty, I have to admit. Okay, so in my head, a fish is something like that. I hope there is no specialist no fisherman on the chat. So this is my fish. Okay, it's very, very, very ugly, but this will work. Let me modify a little my points and unvisualize it. So this is what I get now. These are my fishes turning around the sphere. So I can put the auto illuminate of this on off. So 0%.
Jacob, very happy.
Cool. And apply just a little position noise to my motion, to my random point. So decrease the opacity of my motion, my position noise. Okay. So and play standalone. And now the last things I do is to add a point light at the middle by displaying the meshes. So maybe 100 like this, and put at the end as a special layer a volumetric light, and decrease also the range of my light to something, I guess something like that. Tuk, tuk, tuk. So this is one technique to use motion lines. So of course, if you draw better than me, your fishes will be nicer. But this is one of the main usage of motion lines is also to create objects.
Okay.
And of course, yes, thank you, Basil. Of course, you can use pictures as generators for default lines. It's not just as the uniform. So, for example, there is one that works very, very well. It's to add as renderer a thick line, and I think we have the barbed wire. So barbed wire is this picture, so it's pictures of barbed wire. Let's increase the weight of this and put the auto illuminate to 0. So this is what you create also thanks these techniques of motion lines. So you can increase also the length of your motion lines to get some circles, and this is what you get. Putting the Hello. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, parfait. Je ne sais plus quand est-ce que c'était avant. Ah, mais je sais bien que je voulais, mais évidemment, je m'arrête pas.
Quand vous expliquez. You are back online.
So yes, I was speaking about the renderer of the thick lines. So this is a
barbed wire you created, and you just showed with the 3D transform before the motion lines, you get a better result. Inside the motion lines, you can change the length of the lines. Yeah, I think that's the main trick with motion lines and thick lines renderer. So you can see other examples. Yeah.
You can also, so you don't hesitate to use it with particles. Let me just deactivate what I have done before. Maybe decreasing also just the number of the particles in emits, so to 100 instead of 1000, and use another renderer as to trace the movement of your particles, which is the tube lines. And so tube lines will create this this shape also. And I think it's also a trick, Francis, the tube lines, just like the box or the ballpoints, right?
Yeah, it's a kind of it's a kind of instantiate which is very specialized.
Okay.
So it's faster than the general instantiate, and it precisely follows the curve of the movement.
Okay, so this is what you can create also as shape for motion lines. And one thing very very cool to know is to add also a points. A point attribute to a point scale attribute before the motion lines also. So if you put this at zero, let me just check if my point attribute, oh, it's after the motion lines. Well, if you put this at zero, the scale of your tube will not be displayed. And you can mask your point scale thanks a function too. So this is what you get. You have a point scale in linear, so your tube lines is thicker at the beginning and get the original size of your tube at the end of it. So you can change the linear to sinus. And here the tips is to invert the function, and this is what you get. This is the shape you get in 3D. So I already explained how to create shape like this in 2D by simply create a smooth shape thanks the shape layer. And this is how you get this in 3D. So I think this one also can be useful for motion designer to create maybe movement accentuation visually or something else. I don't know. If you add a position noise before the motion lines, this is the shape it creates. So this might be fun for some people to know these tips. Francis, if you want to...
Yes, I will take over. So maybe just putting back the light since we are there.
Yeah.
Oh, you want to save?
No, it's not me. I think it's Basil that want to save the composition. Okay.
Okay. So because I love your light and your volumetric layer, I'm going to put it back. And we are proceeding to the next topic. So just let's increase this. Okay. So now, if we want every particle to emit trails of particles, there is a solution for this, which is the effect the operator calls emits particles. So it's an operator, and you can find it here in particles. So maybe first we are going to slightly simplify the situation so that we will go back to this afterwards. But we can just start with something simple, because emit particle is not very trivial to understand from the start. So that's where we are for the moment. We have some simple particles. Let's also remove the noise and the fields. Okay, the vortex field is nice. So we have these points. Now, if you put the emit before this, here is what happens. So it's not very clear, but 100 times per second, it will pick up randomly one of the particles and emit, okay, maybe without the vortex, and emit a particle from there. So to make this a bit more clear, we are going to emit particles that have a short lifetime, so let's say 2 seconds. And we are going to emit many more of them. So for example, I add 2 zeros here. Okay, and now we start to see the trails appearing. I'm also going to reduce the number of primary particles to only 10. And I'm going to do a last change, which is to change the direction of the emitted particles to random. And I can also slightly increase the speed of those particles. And now we just created trails. 3 is probably too much. So here are our trails, but what happened is we replaced the source particles by the primary particles, we replaced them by the secondary particles. And often what we want is to keep a display for the primary particles and to have a separate display for the secondary particles. So the trick to achieve this is to group the renderer you want for the secondary particles, so with Ctrl-Shift-G. And once you have a group, you can move the emit particle inside this group. So now the emit particle becomes part, so it's complaining because I'm asking fixed update frame rates and the machine is not fast enough. So I can just uncheck this and the simulation will be a bit more approximate, but don't complain anymore. So and now the fact to emit these particles is part from this group renderer. So we can combine it with any other renderer. So I can, for example, recreate a sprite renderer, which one? Flare sprites, maybe. Okay. So now this affects the primary particles, and this group renderer here generates the secondary particles and then displays them with the dedicated renderer. So, and all of this, we can, of course, still combine it with the previous renderer. And for this, we simply need to reactivate the motion lines. Here they are. And we can reactivate the different fields we had. So I the default lines, two lines, and the group should be at the bottom. Okay, so the motion line in the same spirit of the emit particle, we should make it local to one of the renderers. So we will take this tube line renderer that Erwan made before, group it with Ctrl-Shift-G. And now we can make the motion line local to this renderer. That's really the good way to work because then the modifiers are local to each of those. And by the way, I think I'm still working in the very old way of working because since a number of versions, you can directly put the modifier inside the renderer simply. So the emit particle can be inside this renderer. And that's actually a better way, much more clear. So I forgot that. And now we have our different. Okay, but it's not working. So you should use the group technique I did just before. Sorry about that. We will be back with all our renderers. Do we have some questions, Erwan?
No, there is no question right now.
Okay, so I'm going to rename those in order to save this compo, and then we can put it available on the website of SWAD Academy. So these are, how do you call them, Erwans, your beasts?
I call my motion lines. Motion lines.
Let's say the motion tubes. feedback is still quite slow for us. These are the secondary particles, the trails. And note that here we are creating particle trails from particles, but you can also create particle trails from any geometry, actually, from the vertices from any geometry. So for example, we could take this this particle trails renderer we just made and export it into a material bank. This is always a good practice if you want to share the renderer in multiple situations. So now the trails renderer with the internal emit particle is part of the material which is inside the material bank. And thanks to this, I can go back to another piece of content. And add this renderer at this location. So the idea is that if really you work with particles, the idea is to create your material banks. And now we are using, maybe I need to instantiate this one. Thanks. I'm not exactly sure why it's not working, but that's basically the idea. Oh, due to the machine line again. I got trapped two times. Okay. And if we want to combine with the previous technique, we should put the barbed wire. Again, we should put everything in the material box. And once everything is clearly separated, it's very easy to combine the things as we want. So that was it about particles. Just to mention, there is a whole part that we did not cover, but I encourage you to discover it by yourself. And this part are the actions and rules that you can create in particles. So just in a few words, the idea is to change properties of the particles depending on some actions that happen to them. So for example, when they collide, they get bigger, or when they reach 80% of their edge, some events happen to them, etc. So in case you want to investigate this, the best you can do as usual is to use the F1 shortcuts, and you will have directly the documentation associated to these elements. So as the same, you can use the F1 shortcuts on any field and you will get some information of this field and masks and others. So did I forget something, Erwan?
No, I don't think so. Yes, so documentation is one of the most important part of every users,
so yes,
I strongly advise you to.
We did it also to show this example compo. So this example provided.
Yes.
And a good illustration of the type of techniques that you saw today. So here there are some custom blurs on top of the final image to really get the final look. But if we exclude the blurs, this is a system of particles without any 2D post-processing. And you will see the different techniques that we saw, fields, emit particles, attributes that change depending on different selectors, one which is the depth, another one which is the edge, multiple sprites inside, and actually the sprites are directly processed with modifiers. You could also create a compose in this one. So this is a good example of all the techniques we saw today. And I think the last thing to do is to discuss about what's next tomorrow. And maybe you can explain us this, Erwan.
Yes. So tomorrow I will be with Quentin Brach, a friend of mine. And together we have an audiovisual show entirely made on SMUD, and we will present you how it works, what's the objective of this show. It's totally generative, totally music reactive, MIDI controlled and random based. So I'm very happy to present it to you, and I hope it will interest you too. So that's
thank
it.
You everyone, and I hope you enjoyed this session, and see you tomorrow on Smart Academy.
See you guys.
Good evening. Bye.
Ciao.